Wonderful. Well, good morning, church friends, family. It is Easter Sunday morning, and as we say every Easter, every resurrection morning, we say, Christ is risen, with the response, He is risen indeed. So from your own home, okay, and from our home here, I'm going to say Christ is risen, and everyone here is going to say, He is risen indeed. Okay, ready? Ready for that? And you do it from your home. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Indeed. Amen and amen. This is Resurrection Sunday morning. And from our Gilmore Church Home Edition, from our home to your home, a happy Easter and praise our Lord Jesus Christ that He is alive. We're going to begin this morning with a reading of Scripture from Matthew 28, it is the resurrection account. I want to thank Neil who recorded himself reading the resurrection account this morning. I'm going to play that reading. If you want to follow along in your Bible, if you have a Bible close at hand, grab that, flip to Matthew 28, and we're going to hear Neil read that chapter to us. It's the resurrection story. So let's hear that now.
Verses 1 to 20. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, 'His disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep.' If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen to that. Amen. We're going to sing in just a moment, "Christ Arose." You heard the beginning. But before that, we want to sing "Alive, Alive, Alive Forevermore." And this is a song that Jane has been learning with Mummy. And if you know it from your home, and I bet you do, let's sing it together, okay? So ready, Jaina? And I think Elizabeth will join us in a moment. We're going to sing "Alive, Alive, Alive Forevermore." There you go. Now you can skip. You want to get back on there? Okay, do you remember this song? Remember "Alive, Alive, Alive Forevermore"? Alive, alive, alive forevermore. My Jesus is alive, alive forevermore. Jesus is alive. Thank you, Elizabeth, and thank you, Jaina, for that lovely singing with us, and from you from your home. It'd hardly be at Easter morning at Gilmore without seeing these great hymns of the faith, "Christ Arose" and "Christ the Lord is Risen Today." Thank you, Heather Nechtel, for recording these the piano accompaniment this morning, and let's sing along from these great hymns, "Christ Arose." And thank you, Joseph, for doing our PowerPoint again today. Thank you. amen and amen. Now, I missed our call to worship and opening prayer. So we're going to go back. Joseph, can you flip back? I know Brent is with us this morning on the screen again. And Brent, thank you for doing our call to worship and opening prayer. Let's hear now and share in this moment.
Welcome to this time of worship. We serve an awesome God, a resurrected King, and I'm so glad that you can worship with us today. Wherever you're joining us from, welcome, and I'm so glad that you can be with us. In God's Word, we are invited to come and to worship Him, and this morning's call to worship is from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, God, we are in awe of You, especially this morning, God, when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Lord, we acknowledge that this is Your work and Your doing, and we are just so glad to be able to reflect upon it and what it means for us. Thank You, God, that You have brought us into a new birth and that we have a living hope in Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, God, for calling us to worship You. Thank You for each one that's joining us in worship today. I pray that we would each know You in a deep and personal way as we grow with You, as we seek to love You with everything we are and love those around us the way You have loved us. Thank You, God, for this time. I ask that everything we do this morning, every thought, every word would bring You glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I want to thank you, Brent, for that prayer and scripture reading this morning. We're going to continue in song to sing Christ the Lord is Risen Today, another wonderful hymn of the faith that many, many, probably millions of believers are singing around the world this morning. And let's sing this together. Singing. I imagine it was wonderful singing in your home too. We're going to continue and sing a song that was referenced in Brent's scripture reading this morning, Living Hope. We have a living hope through our Lord Jesus Christ. And what a living hope that is. It's alive. Our hope is alive. So from your home to ours, let's sing. Let's continue in our worship of our risen King. And sing this song, Living Hope. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, this point in our service, we have our children's moment again. I want to thank Pastor Brenda for that. So if you can direct your attention to the screen again, and let's watch together.
Good morning, boys and girls. I'm glad that you're back with us. Happy Easter. Well, you'll remember our story on Good Friday was about Jesus being buried in the grave. And the stone was put in front of the grave so that no one could take him out. Well, Sunday morning, Mary went running to the tomb, and she was going to put some more spices on Jesus' body. But when she got there, she couldn't believe it. The stone had been moved away. And she could see that she could see something in the tomb. So she went running back to the disciples, and she said, "Come quick, come quick. The stone has been rolled away." And so they came running back, and they went into the tomb, and they found that Jesus was not there anymore, but just his white cloths that were around him were in the tomb. So Mary peeked in, and she could see there was the clothing from her tomb, and there was the cloth that was wrapped around Jesus' head. And here was the cloth that was around his body. And she looked, the disciples went away, and she looked more, and she said she could see two angels in there. And she said, "Where have you taken my Lord?" And they said, "He is risen. Go and tell his disciples." So she went out of the cave, and she saw a man standing over by the side, and she thought, "I think he must be the gardener." So she said to him, "Where have you taken my Jesus? If you will tell me, I will come and look after him." And the gardener said to her, "Mary." And when she heard the sound of his voice, she knew it was Jesus. He was alive again, and she was so happy. And we are all happy too that Jesus came alive again. Because he came alive again, he lives with us all the time. He is always with us, and he loves us, and he will never leave us. So let's say thank you to God for this wonderful gift. Let's pray, and we'll do our repeat prayer. Dear God, thank you that Jesus came alive after his death.
After his death.
Thank you that he lives.
Thank you that he lives.
Forevermore.
Forevermore.
And that he loves.
And that he loves.
Everyone in this world.
Everyone in this world.
Help us.
Help us.
To always trust him.
To always trust him.
And to tell him we are sorry.
And to tell him we are sorry.
When we do wrong things.
When we do wrong things.
Because then
he will forgive us.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You have a good day now.
Wonderful. Thank you, Pastor Brenda. We have also at this moment an opportunity for you to see some of the Easter displays that have been made by the children. So a little video has been put together that Brenda put together for us, and we're going to see that now. So let's watch that video.
Thank you.
Wasn't that great? Wasn't that great? Thank you all the children who included their Easter display. And that's great. And if you hadn't done one, it's not too late. You can still do one today. That's great. Great activity. A lot of fun to do that. We have at this time in our service a special music this morning. Sorry, just before a special music. We do have a special music coming, and we'll thank you, Heather, for that in a moment. Yesterday, I posted a question. It might have been Friday. I forget now. Posted a question. How has Jesus changed your life? I got the idea from a pastor out somewhere in California, I think it was, who was talking about how Easter is a little different this year, right? We're not able to meet together physically right now, although we're together in spirit, to be sure. But he was encouraging people to post something on social media or communicate in some other way that we're used to communicating. How Christ has changed our lives, how Jesus has changed us. And so I want to thank those who responded to that question I posted on Facebook and Instagram just the other day. Amy's going to read some of those responses. So thank you, Amy. Be encouraged.
Okay. So these are some of the replies that from one of Ben's relatives, Mariska. She wrote, "I was lost and he found me." From Debbie, a family friend of ours in Northern Ontario, she said, "In the midst of tragedy, he was my peace beyond my human understanding. He still is." And from our Gilmore family, Vicky wrote, "Jesus guided me through every step in my life, bringing me to Canada, where I married the man he chose and gave me beautiful children and grandchildren, and led me to 4 different churches in Canada, where I've had the privilege of serving and being encouraged to grow. I've been blessed knowing my Lord in so many ways I cannot count. He has been with me everywhere I went." Joshua 1:9. Mimi says, "Jesus introduced me to my in-laws via Jim. They are the reason I learned of God's undying love for me, his faithfulness. My faith has rescued me many times, and he continues to wrap me in his love." Laura says, "I don't think I would have made it through many difficult times in my life without Jesus as my guide. He has shown me that I can lean on God for strength." Olivia says, "He gives me more reasons to praise than to fear, and casts out all anxiety and doubt. His love is so deep and so wide. All he wants in return is my love." Sarah has said, "With one prayer, I was rescued from a world that I should have never come out alive from. But God heard my cry, and within seconds, my life was saved. There is power in prayer." Fraser has said, "He has taught me reliance on him in everything and has breathed new purpose into each day that I live." Glenn has said, "He has given me a deep desire to positively impact people, both practically and spiritually." Jacob wrote, "Jesus has saved me from the penalty of sin and given me all I need to live a meaningful and purpose-driven life." And Lindsay, "Having a personal relationship with Jesus has changed not only my life, but for my kids. It's the peace we have to lean on him when life gets scary and we fear the unknown. To be loved so much makes it easier for us to love others, even when it's not always easy." And Taylor wrote, "Before Jesus, I was lost and lived to please people. Now that I have Jesus in my life, I have purpose. I have a reason to embrace suffering. And every day is another day to serve and love others well for kingdom purposes. I am overflowing with thankfulness." And she wrote from Psalm 98, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. Make a joyful noise before the Lord the King. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell in it. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity.
Amen. Amen. Thanks, Amy. Beautiful.
Amen.
Amen. Amen to that. Sorry. Incredible. I hope that you'll take a moment today, as I will, and post something in response to this question. How has Jesus changed your life? Doesn't have to be in the link that I made, but just on your own social media, on your own Facebook page or wherever, respond to that question. How has Jesus changed your life? If it's, you know, it could be 1 minute, could be 10, whatever it is. Let people know what Jesus has done, what the risen Lord has done in your life. It'll certainly encourage many, many people. I believe it's at this time we have a special music for you to enjoy. And is that right, Joseph, in the next slide? Yeah, the song is called The Sacrificed Lamb. And Heather's going to sing that for us. She has a few words to introduce the song, and then she will sing. So I hope you enjoy this this special music. So let's hear now from our sister Heather. Yeah, from who's coming to us today, as you will hear from Bethany.
Morning, Gilmore Baptist Church, and happy Easter. It's Heather Nechtel calling in from Bethany, Ontario. The song I've got here for you is called The Sacrificed Lamb. It was written by Joel Chernoff, a Messianic Jew and a member of a music group called Lamb. And the importance of this song is that it talks about the anticipation of the Jews for thousands of years for the coming Messiah, and how Jesus, Yeshua, is that promised Messiah and is that sacrificed lamb that takes away the sin of the world.
Cleanse everyone.
Thank Heather for that ministry of song, that ministry of music today. At this time, we're going to turn to God's Word and my message this morning, which is called The Fourfold Resurrection Response. So if you have a Bible, and I hope you do nearby, you're at home, so chances are you do have a Bible. Please grab one. By the way, if you don't, email me, let me know, we'll make sure you get one. Please turn in your Bibles now to Matthew chapter 28, and I'm going to grab my Bible, Matthew 28. So I put my Bible down somewhere, so it happens on live streaming, and it happens when I'm not live, but I put my Bible down. I don't know where it's gone. Kids, do you know, you see where I put my Bible? Oh boy, I can't believe I've lost my Bible already. Okay, well, is it? Okay, thanks, Joseph. I got this one. All right, great. Matthew 28. I hope you're there. We're looking at the fourfold gospel response, and I've just lost my PowerPoint helper. Joseph, gonna need your help again. Thank you. Great. Want to begin though with this, with a short story, and one that comes out of from the ends of the earth, quite literally. In 1984, a couple named Mark and Gloria took their two children to Papua New Guinea. They left behind their Mennonite community in Pennsylvania and their lives as dairy farmers to serve as missionaries in, as I said, what we might call the uttermost part of the earth. They settled with the Mauk tribe in a very remote part of Papua New Guinea. The tribe had no previous exposure to God's word. So after learning the language and culture, Mark began to teach the Bible, starting with Genesis. And the entire village of over 300 people came to every teaching session. After weeks and weeks of teaching, twice a day, Monday to Friday, Mark came to the story of the crucifixion. And the people, the Mauk people, were visibly distraught to hear that Jesus, whom they had come to love and believe was God, had been killed on the cross to bear our sins. Then came the next lesson, and that was the resurrection story. And when they heard that Jesus rose again 3 days later, people started shouting in their native tongue, "Itau, Itau," which means, "It's true, it's true." They declared one by one, "I believe, I believe, I believe." Then nearly the whole village joined in. Everyone saying they believe that Jesus has taken their sins upon himself. Then Mark explained to them that when they put their faith and trust in Jesus, he forgives them of their sins and gives them eternal life. The response to that good news, that gospel, that the resurrection of our Lord was so incredible that they made a documentary of it called E-Tau. I'll email that to you later if you're on our email list. It's absolutely incredible. For more than 2.5 hours, the entire village started jumping up and down. They jumped up and down, they jumped and they shouted, and they couldn't contain themselves for hours. They were so excited about the truth of our risen Lord Jesus Christ. They responded in worshipful praise. Dear friends and congregation, as I said, the title of my message here this Resurrection Sunday is a fourfold resurrection response. I want to glean a response from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Yeah, let's look at the next slide here. Thanks, Joseph. And the first response we're going to look at from Matthew comes from chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. So if you have your Bible there, I hope you do. Look at Matthew 28, and in particular, look at verses 9 and 10. Now, some of these responses that we're going to look at here today are responses that the disciples had, and in one case, a response that Jesus wants them to have. Okay, so the first one from Matthew 28, if you want to hit the down arrow there, is worshipful praise. I want us to notice from Matthew, in both accounts of the resurrection, so in chapter 28, Matthew tells of two events where Jesus appeared to the disciples after he rose again. And in both events, the disciples respond in worship. Look at verses 9 and 10, Matthew 28. He's with the, it's the women who have come to the tomb, the Marys. And what does he say? Behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet. And what did they do? They worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." And later, at the end of the chapter now, just a few verses later, they're now in Galilee. And what do we read? Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. Verse 17 says, "And when they saw him, they worshiped him." There it is again. They worshiped him. But Matthew adds, some doubted. So here at the beginning of Matthew and the end of Matthew chapter 28, there's two things that happen. Twice Jesus appears, and they meet Jesus with worship. They worship him. This is a beautiful response, a resurrection response. Worship, worshipful praise. Wonder, worship, praise, adoration. Not unlike the Melk tribe in Papua New Guinea when they heard that Jesus rose from the dead and paid for their sins. They jumped up and down for more than 2 hours. You know, the resurrection, which is so central to the good news of the gospel, calls for this kind of response in every heart. Jesus is alive. And therefore, he who is the Son of God, the risen one, is worthy of our worshipful praise. So worshipful praise, worship, praise, adoration. That's response one. Let's look at Mark now. What can we glean from Mark's account of the resurrection? We can glean courageous proclamation. Courageous proclamation. I'm going to read from Mark 16, 1-8, which says this. When Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary mother of James and Salome, brought spices that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, that early Sunday morning, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb, and they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back, and it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on a table, dressed in a white robe. And they were alarmed, and he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now, interesting thing we see here in Mark's gospel, and, And we see it emphasized actually in each of the gospel accounts that fear is a frequent response to the resurrection. Over and over again, the word fearful is found, or troubled is found, in these gospel resurrection accounts. And over again, Jesus responds with words like, "Do not be afraid. Why are you troubled? Peace be with you." Our risen Lord calls for courage and not for fear. Notice at the end of Mark's gospel, at the end of the chapter, we see Jesus saying this in verse 15. He says, "Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole of creation." Go and proclaim. Go and proclaim. Luke records it this way in chapter 24. I'll flip up to chapter 24 of Luke. Chapter 24, verses 44 to 49. What does he say in Luke's gospel? He says to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are my witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Though fear initially grips the disciples, they take the word of God to heart and they obediently proclaim the good news. Loved ones, where would we be today if the disciples had stayed in fear? Where would we be today if they hadn't courageously proclaimed the gospel to the whole world? You know, so we read that they were afraid to begin, but you know what we find out later, and through the early church fathers and through the historical accounts, that each of these disciples gave their life for the good news of Jesus Christ. They gave their lives. They died in spreading the good news. Worshipful praise. Courageous proclamation. Now in Luke chapter 24, I want us to notice a third response, and that is faith-filled perception. Faith-filled perception. Notice in Luke's gospel, verses 1 to 12 of chapter 24. Luke 24, 1 to 12. "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared, and they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And while they were perplexed about this, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel, and they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground. And the men said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered to the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise.' And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened." The response, as I said, I want to point out here is faith-filled perception. You know, there were those in Jesus' inner circle who really struggled to believe in the resurrection. They seemed perplexed, as Luke tells us, from the beginning. They were perplexed. They were challenged to perceive the message that even the women had told them when they got back. Look at in verse 11 again. What does it say? That when the woman came back to see to tell the disciples that Jesus was alive, it says in verse 11 of Luke 24, it seemed to those disciples an idle tale, and they did not believe them. In verse 38 to 39 of chapter 24, later in the text, Jesus appears to the disciples. But what do we see happening there? Verses 38 and 39. He says to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." It tells us something interesting about our resurrected bodies, but certainly Jesus didn't want them to stay in doubt and stay in disbelief. That very day that Jesus rose from the dead, he rose and walked rather with two of his followers to a village called Emmaus. They walked and walked, and Jesus spoke to them. Verses 27 to 31 record this incredible story on the road to Emmaus. And notice what we find out in verse 27. We see that, "And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he," that is Jesus, "interpreted to them," to those that were walking to Emmaus with him, "all the scriptures and all the things concerning himself. And they drew near to the village which they were going, and he acted as if he were going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent.' So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them." Verse 31, "And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight." So even those two followers of Jesus, they couldn't quite perceive that they were walking with the risen Lord all that way to Emmaus, all that time. And all that time Jesus was teaching them and helping them understand the gospel from the Old Testament to the New. Then their eyes were opened. Then their eyes were opened. You know, there's a book and there's a movie called The Case for Christ. It tells the story of a guy named Lee Strobel, who was an investigative journalist in Chicago. Now, he was determined to prove the resurrection wrong, to prove that it didn't happen. And he went to great lengths to try and do so. You know, in the end, with all his investigative skills, he could not prove the resurrection wrong. And Lee Strobel came to believe in Jesus Christ. And he wrote about it in that book, The Case for Christ, which is now a movie, The Case for Christ. You know, we all know people that doubt the resurrection. And if that's you listening here today, I pray that the eyes of your heart would be opened like those that were walking with Jesus to Emmaus. I pray that you would recognize the risen Lord Jesus. You know, pick up a Bible and start reading in the Gospel of John or the Gospel of Matthew. You pick up a copy of The Case for Christ to hear Lee Strobel's story. Read with a prayerful heart. Read with a heart of faith. Finally, I want us to look at John. I want us to look at a response to the resurrection from the Gospel of John. And Joseph's going to put that last point up for us. Thanks, Joseph. Passionate pursuit. So there's praise, there's proclamation, there's perception, understanding, and pursuit. I just love the Gospel of John and how we see Peter in particular responding to the resurrection, responding to the risen Lord Jesus Christ. Look at John chapter 21. Flip there if you're not there already. John chapter 21. I'm going to read verses 1 to 8 and then 15 to 19. "After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias," which is the Sea of Galilee. "And he revealed himself in this way: Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. And Simon Peter said to them, 'I'm going fishing.'" Well, that's something he was used to doing. So there he goes. He's hops in the boat. He's hungry. And they said to him, we're going to go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? And they answered him, no. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. And the disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, that's probably John. John says to Peter, it is the Lord. It is the Lord. And he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work. So he's in his undies, and he puts on his outer garment, and he threw himself in the sea. And the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far off from the land, about 100 yards off. Okay, I want to stop here for a minute, and I just love what we see here. Here is Peter. He hears that the risen Lord Jesus is on the shore. He hears it's his best friend, but one that he has denied in recent days. But what does he do when he hears that it's Jesus? He jumps out of the boat. He dives into the water because he wants to be with Jesus. Now, I can't help but think about the passion of Peter and the pursuit in his heart for the Lord. He wanted to be with Jesus. He wanted Christ to be near him. And I think it's a beautiful lesson for us, a beautiful example for us of our resurrected Lord. Here's the question. Are you pursuing him? Are you passionately pursuing him? If Jesus knocked on your door today, would you drop everything in order to be with him? Or might you be tempted to say, Jesus, would you come back another time? I'm a little busy right now. Oh, I hope that we would be like Peter, right? And just be willing to drop everything. Drop the nets. Drop what you're doing to be with Jesus. Oh, that we would pursue him. It's beautiful what Jesus said to Peter that day on the shore. Verses 15 to 19 tell us of John chapter 21. It says, when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And he said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him a second time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said to him, tend my sheep. A third time, he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was grieved because he had said to him the third time, do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. For every time Jesus was denied by Peter, Jesus asked the question. Three times denied, three times Peter was asked, do you love me? And three times Peter responds. Peter's being restored. Notice this, verse 18. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you're old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. And this he said to show what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after that, he said to him, follow me. Follow me. Peter, we know, would die with his arms stretched out. He would die by crucifixion. But church historians tell us that he felt unworthy to die in the same manner, so he asked to be crucified upside down. Peter would end up giving his life in pursuit of Jesus. He followed Jesus. He loved Jesus. And he gave his life. Oh, that we would pursue our Lord Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, that we would be filled with faith as we understand this miracle of the resurrection. It is a miracle. And yes, it can be hard for some people to grasp, but believe it. Believe it. Be courageous in your proclamation of the good news. Think to yourself this week, even today, how might we share the good news of Christ in this changing time? Certainly there are opportunities to share with people what Easter really means to us, what the resurrection really means to us. And let's worship Him. As the disciples worshiped the risen Lord, let our lives be marked with worshipful praise of Jesus our King. Think about ways that you can apply that this week in your own home, with your families, personally, in your work settings, in your neighborhoods. Pray that God will just lead you in your application of these great truths today. With God's help, I believe we can grow in these things. And may God be glorified in our lives as we respond to the resurrection today and as we respond to the resurrection every day. Father, do help us, we pray. Grant us the grace, Lord, the courage that we need. Father, grant that we might be found faithful to praise You, to proclaim You, to truly perceive, to truly understand You, to pursue You with a passionate heart. Forgive us, Lord, we pray, when we've pursued other things, when we've taken our eyes off You, when we've taken our eyes off You, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Draw us closer to Yourself this Easter, we pray. Draw us into a deeper fellowship, a closer walk, Lord, for this is truly why we have been made. To know You. To love You. And that love would change the way we live. That we might love others, our neighbors, our co-workers, our families, as we love ourselves. Thank You, Jesus, for the miracle of the resurrection, that You conquered death, that death no longer has a victory, death no longer has a sting, because You have been victorious. That gives us great hope today and for always. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to close with a wonderful hymn, modern hymn that we love to sing, that is so full of truth, In Christ Alone. I hope you all sing it with me. If you want to stand, if you like standing, go ahead. Or sitting, In Christ Alone, we shall sing together to close the service this morning. And after, I'm going to encourage you at around 12 noon to go outside on your porch at 12 o'clock and sing. I want to thank Mary for that idea that we would all at noon go and sing on our porch of the praises of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's sing together now, though, In Christ Alone. Elizabeth, then join me. Thanks, dear. All right. Of love. Let's close with a word of benediction. I wonder, Joseph, would you be up for reading our benediction today? Just hit that slide one more time. I'd love to have you part of this. Thank you so much. We're going to have it on the screen. You can just, just read it from there and read it in that loud voice. Thank you so much.
And now, may the God of peace, who brought back again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Christ, all that is pleasing to him. To him be the glory and forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Joseph. Amen to that. Lord bless you today. The Lord keep you and make his face to shine upon you. I encourage you, as we have that one more slide to show you, if you're able, stand on your porch at noon and sing. Sing songs of praise to our risen Lord Jesus Christ. And God bless you today, this Easter Sunday. Go in peace.